Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you that you've gathered us together in the presence of your Son. For he has promised that the two or three are gathered in his name. There he is in his son. So we welcome you, Lord Jesus. We praise and worship you and glorify you. Lord, we give you what belongs to you, our very selves. But Lord, as we come before you, we ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit into our hearts. Open our eyes to see and our ears to hear and our hearts to receive your word. So that your word would be planted deeply in our hearts and bear fruit for eternal life. And that we would act on your word in such a way as to reveal the coming of the kingdom as your Holy Spirit moves forth to confirm the word and bless people's lives and bring them to the knowledge of salvation. And now, Lord, I pray that the word of my mouth and meditations of our hearts would be truly acceptable in your sight, our strength and our leader. Amen. Grace and peace from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Last week, or really even at the start of Pentecost, we began to talk about what the Holy Spirit does in the lives of Christians. And last week we talked about that there are two doors that the Holy Spirit wants to bring us through. The door of salvation, which includes the new birth and authority, and then the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that brings us into the power to act on what he's given us. Now, last week, we talked about the new birth. Today, I want us to consider that the Holy Spirit also brings us into authority. Because what the Holy Spirit does is he creates in us a new creation, a new creature, no longer based on the old Adam, but on the new Adam, Jesus. We are recreated into his character and into his being. And as the Holy Spirit does that, the Holy Spirit then places us in a new level, a different place than we were prior to the new birth. And it's a place of authority. Now, what do I mean by that? What does the Bible mean by that? Because we see that in many different places. Really, in order to understand what we're talking about, what the Holy Spirit is doing, we need to go back to the beginning. In Genesis chapter 1, we read that in the beginning, when God created human beings, he created them in his image, and he gave them dominion over everything in the earth, and everything in the heavens, and everything in the waters. And we find in Genesis 2 that that also included the spiritual aspects of the world, that God gave to the human beings dominion. Now, that dominion means to rule. It doesn't mean absolute rule, but it does mean to rule. In other words, the human beings, made in the image of God, had given to them by God authority delegated to them so that they could rule and reign on earth in the name of God according to his word. So that whenever they would speak a thing, according to the word of God, it would come to pass. By the way, that's something that we need to remember. That is the basis for human power. Not our own strength, but God working through us to make things happen. You ever think about this? You know, I remember long before I became a pastor, I was very interested in science, and I was in biology, and I one of the things that was always a mystery to me, and I always thought that evolution was wrong, but in many, many, many different ways. But one of them is this. This whole idea that somehow the fittest survive. Well, if that's true, if it's all based on power, well, think about human beings for a minute. We are the least fit thing to live. We don't have claws. We're not very strong. We're not very fast. We have to think about what tools to make before we make them. A lion has claws and teeth. They're faster than we are, stronger than we are. There's all kinds of things out there where we are not at the top of the food chain. We're right down there in the bottom. And yet, we're here. Why? One, because we're blessed. But the other is that human beings originally were created not to rule by might, but by the word of God. You speak it out. And God's word is done. Because real power comes from God. Remember what God said to St. Paul? My power is made perfect in weakness. It's okay that we're not the toughest thing on the block. That makes us perfect for the purposes of God. That's how it was always intended to be. In the beginning, we had dominion based on speaking the word of God according to God's will. And then as we spoke it out, it would come into being. Now there's a problem. And the problem is that sin came into the world. When Satan came and tempted Adam and Eve, what happened? They lost dominion. They became slaves to sin and death and to the devil. As Satan became the, as Jesus said, the ruler of this world. And this world ever since has been controlled by and large by the power of darkness and by the work of the enemy. And human beings lost that dominion that they had in the beginning. But when Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead and ascended into heaven, what do we read in John 1? To those who received him, who believed in his name, he, Jesus, gave the right to be called children of God. Now, this is where we're coming to in regards to authority. What's the word right mean there? You see, if we understand what that word right means there, we will, and we act on it, we will find that the devil will lose all kinds of power that we give to him. Why? Because the word right in the Greek also can be translated power, and also can be translated, actually the word itself is authority. The Greek word is exousia. And it means, literally this, it means to have judicial, royal, magisterial, jurisdictional authority over a given sphere. So, in other words, those who believe in Jesus, who are born again, are made to have rule, authority, to decree a thing as a judge, and make the word of God stick. In other words, when Jesus died, rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, and poured out the Holy Spirit intends to bring us to a place where we are no longer slaves to sin, death, and the devil. We are now redeemed, bought back, and given back our inheritance of having dominion and speaking out the word of God according to the will of God and making it stick. And by the way, we find this declared over and over again throughout the New Testament, and that is what the new birth brings into the believer. For example, in Matthew 16, we read that Peter makes a great confession concerning Jesus. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then what does Jesus say to Peter, but also to the other apostles and the other disciples? He says, behold, I give you the keys of the kingdom. And whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. You know what that is? Authority. You have the authority to speak a thing, decree a thing according to the word of God, and Satan's got to move. He's got to leave. He's got to get up and get out. We find in Luke chapter 10, verse 19, the 72 come back. They've been doing the ministry Jesus gave them to do. And Jesus says, behold, I have given you authority. By the way, it's the same word that's used in John chapter 1. Authority. I have given you judicial, magisterial, royal rule. And there to tread on serpents, scorpions, over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall my enemies harm you. In other words, Jesus gives to the church the authority that was lost when Adam and Eve sinned. so that we can speak a thing according to the Word of God and make it stick in the spiritual world. Jesus says in Matthew 28, after his resurrection, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you." All authority. That word authority is again exousia. Jesus has all royal authority. And then he delegates some of it to his people. And you're to go out in the world, and as the psalm says, you shall decree a thing, and it shall be done for you according to the word of God. So over and over and over again, we are told by our Lord Jesus that he has all authority, and he has given us authority to exercise rule and reign in this life. Actually, St. Paul says that we reign in life with Christ. And in a sense, when we reign in life with Christ, we are getting ready for something even greater, because we're told by St. Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 that in the end, when the new creation is here, he says, "Do you not know that the saints will judge angels?" And in Revelation chapter 20, those who are believers at the thousand-year reign, they will rule with Christ for 1,000 years. So the authority we have now, we are to exercise in the spiritual realm, preparing for the day when we will reign with Christ, when the 1,000 years comes. So over and over and over again, we are told in Scripture that the Holy Spirit brings us to a place of authority. Now, I'm going to stop there because there are a couple of things we need to be clear about. You only have the authority that God gives you. You do not have the authority he does not give you. So, in other words, it makes no sense for any believer to speak out a word that God has not said, or that God that is not written. You don't have the authority to do that. We are judges who only have the authority to speak out and rule on what God has already ruled and already said. It's kind of like, well, let me put it this way. It's kind of how judges are supposed to work in this country. You have rule of law, you have precedent, and you are supposed to rule not based on what you think is right or what you want, but based on what the law says. And you have the authority to declare that this is what the law says and it must be followed. That's what the authority means. You don't make the law, God makes the law. But you have the authority to declare it and to enforce it. That's the authority he's given. Now, that being said, the application I want to give to that with regards to our lives today is this. As I said before, if we would actually take hold of this great truth and run with it, the devil would lose so much of his power that we have allowed him to have in our lives. What do I mean by that? I know lots and lots and lots of Christians, good people, lovely people, but they are beset and attacked by all kinds of evil things like depression, despair, fear, all manner of spiritual attacks being on their life. And there seems to be no end to it. They can't get rid of it. And so they cry out to God, wanting God to do something. And then nothing happens right away. And so they give up. And they allow Satan and those unholy thoughts and unholy feelings to hang around. I want to say right now that you don't have to let them hang around. They are not allowed to stay, but you have to take the authority that God has given you and command them to go. In the name of Jesus, you have to take that authority. What we learn in today's Old Testament lesson is that if you don't take up the authority God's given you, then nothing good's going to happen. You have to take it up. But many times, we forget we have authority, and we don't know we have authority, and so we feel like victims, and we feel like we're just a victim of circumstance, driven along. That is not what God intends. But sometimes, when we cry out to God and nothing happens, it's not that God doesn't care, but there are some things that we ask God to do, and God says, I've already done it. You're the one that has to act on it. For example, Jesus says, I give you the keys of the kingdom. Well, he gives you the keys of the kingdom, what are you supposed to do? Use them. Use them. In today's Old Testament lesson, we find something similar. So the Israelites are up against the Red Sea. The Egyptians are coming down on them. And they cry out to God. Well, that makes sense to me. Why wouldn't you cry out to God? You should. At least I don't think so. And when they cry out to God, then God says something that seems odd. He says to Moses and to the Israelites, why are you crying out to me? Have you ever wondered why it is? He says, why are you doing that? Because to me, when I first read that many years ago, I was like, well, why wouldn't I? The Egyptian army is over here, and the Red Sea is over here. I'm dead meat. You've got to do something. And he says to them, why are you crying out to me? Why does he say that? Here's the reason. He had, many years before, already given Moses and Aaron authority. They had a staff. It was Moses' staff, but Aaron used it from time to time. And whenever they used that staff in the name of God, according to his purposes, awesome things happened. Well, awesome for the Israelites, not really so awesome for the Egyptians. But nevertheless, they were exercising authority. And now here they were at the Red Sea, and Moses and Aaron and the Israelites have forgotten that they still had authority. So God says to Moses, what are you crying to me for? Move forward and lift up your staff. I gave it to you. Use it. And when he used the staff, then the sea opened. The Israelites went through. And the Egyptians got slaughtered. God delegated that authority to Moses. And God said, use it. If you're facing depression, God has given you the authority to tell that demonic spirit to get out. You have the authority, use it. But you know, Satan won't leave unless you tell him to go. He's a squatter. And he won't leave until you command him to get out. And you'll have to get forceful. But you have the Bible, you have the Word of God that says he doesn't have a claim over your life anymore. You have the authority. He really doesn't have a choice. But see, that's why he doesn't want you to know that you have authority. Because if you were to know that he's actually a defeated foe. See, in Colossians chapter 2 and verse 15, we find he's already been disarmed. Triumphed over from Jesus. If you know that he's disarmed, that he doesn't have any teeth anymore, that the only thing he has is bluff. Well then, he's done for it. So what he does is he keeps you from recognizing that you have authority. Yeah, maybe you'll get rid of the devil someday, but right now you just have to put up with it. You double go. In the name of Jesus, get out. And you'll have to keep telling him from time to time. But eventually, he's got to go. It's not a matter of if. It's only a matter of when. But I will give you this hint. If Satan's going to go, if you're going to take authority and command him to leave, leave your thought life, leave your family, leave your home, leave, leave, leave. If you're going to do that, make sure of this one thing. That you are submitted to God. Because it says in Scripture, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Not likely, will flee from you. But if you're not submitted to God, then you no longer have his authority. And therefore, he'll just laugh at you. But if you're submitted to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. And by the way, that's the very image of Jesus. Remember, Jesus was actually a person under authority, under submission. Who was he submitted to? The Father. Jesus was completely submitted to the Father. And therefore, the devil trembled whenever he showed up, because it was his doom. And Jesus says, that same authority I give to you. Now, next week, we'll talk about why we need the baptism of the Holy Spirit to go along with the authority. But I'll just give you a little hint here. You can have all the authority you want as a judge, but if you don't have a police force to back you up, it's all talk. You need power to enforce the law. That's why we need baptism of the Holy Spirit. I'll get more into that next week. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have gathered us together to hear this word. And I pray, Lord, that you would plant deeply in our hearts. Lord, Holy Spirit, that you would come and just bring your power and your wisdom and your understanding into our life so that receiving this word, we would know what to do and how to do it. And Lord, I just declare what your word says, that you have given us authority to stand and command Satan to leave so that we would be free to do the work of the kingdom and so that we would be able to free others for salvation. We thank you for that, and we receive that in Jesus' name. Amen. In our next hymn, 152. Did you sing that already? Well, I think we just did, didn't we? I did not realize it. All right. Let's do 26. Hymn number 26. I decided to follow you.